I'll end with a question that is, I think you all agree or you all disagree, but for the similar reasons. Does the Graviton exist?
Oh, gosh. Well, I'd hope so. I'm not sure whether that's relevant to any... That's something, a different question. Isn't it?
Yes, yes. We're changing gears.
No, well, I would certainly think that's... It has to have... There would be such a thing as a graviton, yes. But this is... You see, gravity, in normal experience, is so weak. I mean, it's to try and see quantum effects in gravitation are extremely difficult. It's not... As a force, it's very, very weak. I mean, it's not... Also, it's not really a force, even. It behaves differently from other standard forces. So I'm not quite sure what the question is here. I mean, it's why is gravitons not observable as such?
No. What I'm wondering is...
Yeah.
In our first conversation, there's plenty of talk about, well, let's not focus so much on quantizing gravity. Let's quote-unquote gravitize or gravitationalize the quantum. In quantum gravity, the graviton makes appearances, but not in all quantum gravities. For instance, loop quantum gravity doesn't have a graviton. We also should have talked about...
I'm not sure about that.
We should have talked about spin networks, actually. That's another conversation.
Yeah.
Anyhow, I wanted to know if, because of the way that you view the world, as in gravitizing the quantum, it doesn't seem like there's room for the graviton to exist.
No, I think that's a bit misleading. That's not my point of view. The trouble, I mean, graviton should exist. It's just we're so far away from anything which would see the... I mean, gravitation is such a macro... You see it as a macroscopic thing. I mean, the fact that we're sitting down on the Earth here, sitting down in our chairs rather than floating around, is because there's an enormous... You have to have something that big in order to see the effect. And so if you want to try and do an experiment in a lab, which is looking for the quantum effects of gravitation, is hugely far off. Doesn't mean I don't think there are such things as gravitons. It just means that the effects of the particle effects of gravitation are so far away from anything one could see in an experiment. It's all right to talk about them, and I do sometimes. But what we see is gravitational fields. And the fields are. But you see, gravity is different in many respects. It doesn't even have an energy momentum tensor in the same way that ordinary things do. I mean, you can force it into it, but it's not. I'm not sure. So I'm not answering your question, really. You see, I think there's a whole subject which doesn't really exist, and I haven't quite thought of a good name for it, which is, I would say, big physics. But big is the wrong word. I'm trying to think of the right word.
Penroseology.
No, that's not the right word. No, it's something to do with it being on a huge scale. You see, what is the biggest stuff in the universe, in a sense, including the biggest mass? Well, it's dark matter. All these particles that we talk about, which are so important to our existence and experiments that are done and all that stuff, they're a trivial correction, if you like, to the big stuff in the world. Now, what's the big stuff? Well, the big stuff is dark matter, which in my view is a form of gravity, and gravitons. Now, they're big stuff. So that to treat them quantum mechanically is a way off, way, way, way off, you see. I mean, it may be that the dark matter particles decay in a way that conceivably could be observed. That would be very exciting if that's the case. But it's a different world almost. I mean, it's not a different world because I was sitting down here in chairs, which are, we're not floating around because of gravity. But it's a different world from the particles and the which behave very quantum mechanically when you go discuss them. But they're a trivial modification to the big stuff, which I'm trying to say. I need a better word for it than that. And the big stuff would be gravitation and dark matter, basically. And cosmological constant in some form comes in. And that there's a whole world of how to describe all that stuff. And the matter is a sort of perturbation.
Mm.
But it's, of course, very important and to us. And what we, our lives are dominated by the small stuff. But I don't know the right way to talk about that. So
you could say dominating stuff, no?
Well, it's certainly dominated. You see, the dark matter is the main stuff. You know, in the solar system, in the galaxy, it's the dark matter. Now, we don't have a proper theory. It's very far from the small stuff which we're made of, and we're a perturbation. If you consider the overall effect of it, we're a little perturbation to what's happening to the big stuff. So it needs a theory of big stuff. And that's really what I'm trying to think about mainly, at least on the physics side. Because the cosmology is very much driven by that kind of thing. Of course, you do have matter playing a role as well, but it's more like a perturbation to what the big stuff is doing. I don't think I'm going to call it big stuff. That's not a very good term. I need something. A grander term. Grand. You could call it the grand stuff. I don't know. It's not quite stuff.
Yvette, does the graviton exist?
I think so, yes. I think gravity should be quantized, so I would disagree with my colleague Jonathan Oppenheim on that. By the way, I love his work. Like, I am a fan of what he does, although I disagree, you know, that gravity is classical, like he proposes. But what I really love about his work is that he comes with his own idea on how would you unify, let's say, a gravitational theory, which is more like stochastic.
Whose work are we talking about?
Jonathan Oppenheim from UCL.
Oh,
yeah. Well, I mean, what he's done that I like is that he proposes an experiment. So that's what I admire of his work. Oh, well, and I also that he comes up with his own idea on how to unify gravity and quantum mechanics. But he does it. He says that gravity should not be quantized, but it's more like a stochastic thing. But then he proposes an experiment. And that's why I love his work so much, because that's it where I want things to go. That we start being creative, we come up with our ideas, we propose things that can be tested in the experiment. And then since experiments are really getting so, you know, they are amazing, and they can go, well, when people would do entanglement on tabletop experiments, now Anton Seilinger has been able to do, demonstrate entanglement across thousands of kilometers using satellites. I mean, you see, the progress has been really amazing in many different directions. So I think that we have to make use of quantum technologies and these improvements in order to find ways of testing the theory. And like we were talking before about how some things maybe look impossible, but if you find the right angle and the right way to post things, then maybe they're more at reach. I also maybe gave you an example of how to do with these states that are kind of the states that already people do in the lab or another ex- example of thinking things in a different perspective, no? So I do think that gravity should be quantized. And I do think that there is a particle, you know, that mediates. I don't know if the graviton is, as in other, you know, candidate theories proposed, but I do think that there might be such a thing, yeah.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high-quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toe listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.